Hi everyone. Today's lesson is really just an extension of yesterday's lesson, which was on radical notation. Today we're just talking about what happens with radicals and roots when you introduce negative numbers into the mix. Yesterday we focused strictly on positive numbers, but with negative numbers there are some different things you have to look out for, some places where you're going to run into undefined expressions and things like that. So that's what we're focusing on today. Just to get us warmed up, take a second and try to fill in this table. So what I'm really asking you to do here is, like for example, take 2 and raise it to the power of 2. So you're doing 2 squared here, which would be 4. Okay? Here you're doing 2 to the third power, which would be 8. And then I want you to do the same thing in the next row. Obviously, you would fill in the rest of these, but do the same thing in the next row except with a negative number. Now remember, in your calculator, if you're going to raise a negative number to a power, it does have to be in parentheses. So negative 2 squared should also come out to be 4. So take a quick second, pause the video, and see if you can fill in the rest of this table on your own. Here's what your table should look like. Okay, so if you haven't filled it in, now would be a great time again to pause and get it filled in. But what I really want you to pay attention to here is what happens in these different columns. Notice that in this column, and this column, all of the numbers are positive, okay? And you end up with like duplicates of the same number that are all positive. That was when the powers were even, right? 2, 4, and 6. In the odd powers, so like 3 and 5, you'll see that they kind of alternate, positive, negative, positive, negative. Because with odd powers, you can raise a negative number to a power and get a negative answer. An even power, like this one, you're never going to get a negative answer. And we've talked about that already, but I just wanted to kind of hit that hard going into this lesson. Okay, let's try the same thing, but let's now take all of our next exponents and make them. So, take a look at this. If you wanted to do 2 to the negative second power, well, let's remember what negative exponents do. Remember, negative exponents mean you're going to make things into the reciprocal, so all of these are going to be reciprocals. So 2 to the negative 2 power would be, well, 2 to the second power is 4, so this would become 1 over 4. And I would like these as fractions, not as decimals. Okay, so again, pause the video, see if you can fill this table in on your own. So again, here's what your table should look like. And notice that really the numbers in this table are exactly the same as the numbers in the last table, just everything has a 1 over it. That's because these exponents are negative. Okay? And you'll see that same thing happening, that when your powers are even, everything is positive. When your powers are odd, you get positives and negatives. And even more interesting is to look at what happens with the negative numbers. Okay? When you're raising a negative number to any power, you'll see that you get kind of this back and forth. Positive, negative, positive, negative, positive. Okay? Positive, negative, positive, negative, positive. Whereas with the positive numbers, they just stay positive all the way through. Again, that's nothing new. That's stuff that we've talked about before. But just wanted to make sure again that we reiterated that point. Let's take a second and talk about the difference between these two things. Okay, now I've mentioned this lots and lots of times before. In fact, I think I've said that this is the one thing I want you to walk out of here knowing. But there's a big difference between this expression and this expression, okay? Because when you type something like this into your calculator follows order of operations really closely. So writing it like this is telling your calculator to take negative 8 and multiply it out 4 times. It's going to look like that. Well, when you do that, these two negatives are going to make a positive, and these two negatives are going to make a positive, and so your answer comes out positive. Okay? But when you write it like this, your calculator does not read this as negative 8 to the power of 4. It reads it as 8 to the power of 4, please make it negative. Okay? Because what it's really reading is this. Okay, it's really treating that negative like a negative 1 out in front. And then by order of operations, it does the exponent first and then multiplies by negative 1. Okay? So 8 to the power of 4 is 4,096. Negative 1 times that, negative 4,096. So depending on how you type it in, you're going to get two different answers. So just make sure that when you are typing something like this into your calculator that you're typing it in appropriately. Now, sometimes you're going to see problems like on your homework that are written like this without parentheses. If it's written without parentheses, it wants you to evaluate it without parentheses. It wants this answer. Okay, so just keep that in mind. Okay, so again, just kind of sticking with this theme of negative numbers kind of mess everything up. Normally, if we were to take the fourth root of x to the fourth power, okay, so this is saying multiply it 4 times and then split it up 4 times, you would just get back to the actual number. An easier way to think about that would be, if you think back to what we did yesterday, we would write this as x to the power of 4 over 4, and 4 over 4 just equals 1, so then you would get x to the first power, which is just x, okay? Same thing over here. This is a square root, so remember there's really a 2 sitting out here. So if I were to rewrite this and simplify it, I would go 10 over 2, which is what I have here, and 10 over 2 reduces to 5. Okay, so what I want to do is try both of these things with a positive x and a negative x and show you the difference. So I'm just going to pick 2 because that's an easy one for me to do in my head. So let's suppose x is equal to 2. Then if I do the fourth root of 2 to the fourth power, well, 2 to the fourth power is 16, so this is really the fourth root of 16. And if I type into my calculator the fourth root of 16, I get 2, which is what my original x value was. That's what I wanted, is I wanted this to come out to be exactly the same as what I started with. Okay? Alternatively, let's look at what happens if I make that x negative. If I go with a negative 2 and I do the fourth root of negative 2 to the fourth power, negative 2 to the fourth power, because that's an even power, is going to come out to be positive 16. So this would still end up being the fourth root of positive 16. Okay, so really this and this come out the same. The problem is when you take the fourth root of 16, you get 2. And that doesn't match what we started with, which is what this expression is saying. This up here says, if I do this, I should come back to the exact number I started with. And here I didn't. Okay, so that's why negative values of x, when you're working with these even powers and even roots, really get messed up. Okay? Same thing over on the other side. Let's see. Can I work with 2 to the 10th? I think I can. Let's suppose I did the square root of 2 to the 10th power. Well, 2 to the 10th power is, hold on just a minute, I'm going to cheat and look it up. I should have known that one. It's 1024. Oh, I'm sorry. That would be the square root. So 2 to the 10th power is 1024. So that would become the square root of 1024. And the square root of 1024 is, oh, please be 32. It is indeed 32. Okay? Which is equal to, because this is saying that when I do that, I should come out with the same thing as x to the fifth power. So my x is 2, 2 to the 5th power is equal to 32, so these come out to be the same. Okay, again, let's try that same thing but with a negative. Let's suppose I made my x equal to negative 2. So when I do the square root of negative 2 to the 10th, well, negative 2 to the 10th, again, because that's an even number of negatives, is also going to come out to be 1024, just like before. And the square root of 1024 is 32. Except this time, when I do this piece, the x to the 5th power, negative 2 to the 5th power, because that's an odd power, is going to come out to be negative 32. So these two things no longer match. Okay, so that's just sort of demonstrating some of the situations that when you work with negative numbers, things don't work like they're supposed to. So just to sort of wrap up what we just talked about, we got used to this expression yesterday. Okay, this is called the nth root of x. And that n could be any number. So it could be the cube root, the fifth root, the 12th root, the whatever. When x is positive, so when this number underneath is positive, this expression is considered to be defined, meaning there's an answer for any value of n as long as it's bigger than 2, because we don't do any root smaller than 2. There's nothing smaller than a square root. Okay, we don't do first roots or zero roots or anything like that. So what this is saying is that anytime this number under here is positive, pretty much you have nothing to worry about. This value of n can be anything you want. When x is negative, however, when this value under here is negative, the only numbers that you're allowed to have out here are odd numbers. And that's really similar to what we talked about last chapter when we said, like, if you have a negative number down here and an even fraction, okay, remember we talked about, like, if this number was even, that was going to be no solution. That's the same thing as being undefined, okay? But if you had a negative number, oh, that's a bad example. If you had a negative number with an even an odd fraction, that would work out just fine. You would just make your answer negative. Okay? So evens are undefined, odds work just fine when you're working with negative numbers. And that's exactly what this expression down here is saying. So now what we're going to do is we're going to fly through these expressions real quick. And I know it's, I need to shrink it up a little bit, but it's probably going to grow as soon as I click to the next slide. And what I really just want to know is which of these are defined, which of these are undefined, okay? And that's sort of what we just talked about. And then would the answer come out positive or would the answer come out negative? Now, the one thing I do want to remind you of, and actually I might take a quick second here. So we said that if this number under here is positive, n can be anything. Okay, no problems. Okay, if this number under here is negative, n has to be odd. If it's even, it's undefined. But I'm going to throw a little wrench into that now. Because remember, way back at the beginning of this semester, we talked about imaginary numbers and how somebody created imaginary numbers because they were bothered by the fact that negative numbers didn't work so nicely under here. So if it's a square root, and remember, when it's a square root, we don't write any number out there, and it's a negative number, that's technically an imaginary number. That would be an imaginary answer, because remember, square roots of negatives are imaginary. Technically, that's defined. Now, it's defined because somebody made up a definition for it, but that is considered to be defined. So, normally, if this n was even, okay, and this was negative, we would say it's undefined. But if it's a square root specifically, and remember, square roots don't have a number out there, but they're really a 2. If it's a square root, they're imaginary. Okay, so that's going to pop up on this next slide, too. Okay, I am going to fly through these pretty quickly, so feel free at any time to stop and pause the video if you need to catch up on writing these down, or you can abbreviate these terms. So, looking at this one, number under here is positive. That means I have no worries. Everything is fine. I'm going to get an answer, which means this is defined, okay, because it's positive, so everything is defined. Everything works. And because it's positive, I know my answer is going to come out to be positive, okay? Now, looking over here at this next one, this is a negative number. That's when I have to pause and think about whether or not this is going to work. This is negative, but this is odd. So this one will work, which means it's defined. However, my answer will come out to be negative. Okay? So again, this one, this is where I have to kind of pause and ask myself, will this work or will it not work? It's negative. Okay? But this time my power is even, so hopefully you see the difference between this one and this one over here. Okay, I have an even root here. So this one's not going to work. It'll be undefined, which means it's not going to be positive or negative. Kind of the same deal here with this one. I've got a negative number with an even root, so that one won't work. one's going to be undefined as well. Now this one, it's a negative number. Technically, this is an even root, okay? So normally I would say undefined, except again, this is a square root. So square roots, someone did make up a definition for them, and they are imaginary, okay? So remember when we did square root of negative 100, we would say it's 10i, okay? So that's sort of like somebody imposing an answer. Somebody, you know, mathematicians of way back whenever decided that they were going to make a definition for square roots of negative numbers, but imaginary numbers don't work for all these other even roots. Okay, this next one, this number is positive, so nothing to worry about, of course, find. And my answer will come out positive. My number under here is positive. My answer is going to be positive. Going down to this next one, it's negative, okay, which means I have to stop and think, but it's an odd power, so that's going to work out just fine. Defined. But since it's negative, my answer will come out to be negative. Okay. This next one, this is positive, so no problems, right? This is going to be defined, and it's also going to come out to be positive. Again, anytime your number underneath is positive, no worries. This next one, though, is negative, okay, with an even root. Negatives and evens do not mix, so that one would be undefined. Okay. So kind of just getting you used to being able to pick out, like, what's defined, what's undefined, and so on. Okay? Okay, so let's actually solve these. The cube root of 27, cube root of negative 27, let's check and make sure it works. This is, I keep doing that to you guys today, sorry. This is negative, but this is odd, so that's going to work just fine. As long as it's odd out here, negatives are fine. So then I would just ask myself, well, what is the cube root of 27? If you needed to, you could do a factor tree. But I am okay with you just typing this into a calculator. If I typed it into a calculator, I would find that the cube root of negative 27 is negative 3. Okay, because the cube root of 27 is 3, and then just slap a negative sign on it. Now this next one, the sixth root of negative 8 squared. Well, negative 8 squared is like negative 8 times negative 8, so that's going to be 64. So really what I'm asking you for is the 6th root of 64. If you broke 64 down into 6 pieces, you would get 2. Okay, and it'd be positive 2 because even though this was negative, when I squared it, it turned back to positive. Now this next one, negative, with an even root on the outside. Those are the ones that don't mix. So this would be no solution, okay? Or you could write undefined, either way. So again, no real new content here. We've talked about all of these negative number issues before, but just wanted to kind of again point out that negative numbers make some weird things happen. So, okay, so after this video, you should now be able to complete the check for understanding. There is a check for understanding that covers both of the last two lessons, radical notation and this lesson. You'll want to get that done, and then you have two worksheets to be working on. So you have two worksheets. You should be working on Lesson Master 8-4-B and 8-7-B. We'll go over those in class on Wednesday, and you have a check for understanding. The two worksheets are technically due Friday. However, I really, really strongly suggest that you start working on them before that, before class on Wednesday, so that we can go over them on Wednesday. Check for understanding is due Wednesday, okay? And if you don't have it done by Wednesday, you won't get a chance to go back and correct it, okay? So you'll want to make sure you get those two things done after you've watched both these videos.